Good afternoon. Welcome to the USJI seminar on US-Japan alliance after the US presidential election. I'm Kasuichi Uchida, president of the USJI and Professor Law at Barcelona. USJI is a non-profit research organization here in Washington, D.C., established in April 2009, jointly managed by 9 leading Japanese universities. The mission of the USJI to promote policy-related research at our member universities, to organize research teams, discuss their research results, to advise the communities through the media of English, to nurture young researchers relating to US-Japan issues, and to coordinate a community of researchers and policymakers. The USJI holds a week-long seminar twice a year, in early March and in September, an occasional seminar for most every month here in Washington, D.C. We have many activities in Japan as well as in the United States, so please visit our website for your information. From Monday this week to Thursday, we hold 8 different events. This afternoon, we have a seminar on US-Japan alliance after the US presidential election, organized and moderated by Professor Koji Murata of Doshisha University. Last evening, President Trump has delivered a speech at the Congress, in which he emphasized the importance of alliance. But at the same time, he said like this, I quote his text, "Free nations are the best vehicle for expressing the will of the people, and America respects the rights of all nations to chart their own path." Then he said, "My job is not to represent the world. My job is to represent the United States of America." So this is what he said last night. And so how can we interpret what he said last night? We need to examine what kind of situation and the future directions of US-Japan alliances from many different standpoints under this changing environment and context. And Professor Koji Murata and Mr. Benjamin himself will discuss this issue. I'm quite sure today's seminar will produce a fruitful and productive discussion. Before introducing and moderating the Professor Murata, I need to receive your permission of being today. No objections, thank you very much. And then videotape will be open to the public through the internet. So let me introduce Professor Murata.
Thank you very much for kind introduction, Professor Uchida. My name is Koji Murata. I'm a professor of political science and the former president of Doshisha University. My colleague, Mr. Benjamin Seo, he is vice president of the Mansfield Foundation located in Washington, D.C., and old friend of mine. Today, we'd like to talk about the state and the challenges for the US-Japan alliance. As Professor Uchida pointed out, more than 1 month has passed since Mr. Trump assumed the presidency of the 45th presidency of the United States, and yesterday he delivered the first State of Union before the Congress. So first of all, I would like to briefly talk about my ideas of the current status and challenges of the US-Japan alliance, and Mr. Seo will deliver his ideas. Then I'd like to open the Q&A session with you. Of course, I do not represent the government of Japan, and I do not represent our university. It's completely my personal view, and there are so many different views about the Trump administration and the US-Japan alliance in Japan, certainly. Okay, let me start. Now, it is 2017, and 100 years ago, 1917, the Russian Revolution happened. And the Russian Revolution was a kind of a rebellion of the peasant, sailors, soldiers, and workers against elite establishment aristocracies. Rebellion against establishment, something similar happens now in the United States and Europe. And 1917, the United States entered into the World War I. And finally, this Grand War was over November 1918. Then the President of the United States, Woodrow Wilson, brought an idea of establishing the League of Nations in order to prevent another great scale of war. But Mr. Wilson proposed the League of Nations, because of domestic politics in the United States, the United States did not join the League of Nations. So without the United Nations, without Soviet Union, without Germany, the League of Nations started with a very weak basis. As a consequence, 20 years later, the League of Nations could not prevent another big war, the World War II. Nowadays, although the Obama administration strongly advocated TPP, Trans-Pacific Trade Partnership, now President Trump declared eternal departure from the TPP. So somehow similar happens right now. About 100 years ago, many new immigrants came to this country from Russia, from East European countries. Then American society caused a kind of negative reaction to the newly coming immigrants. Something similar may happen in this country right now. And 40 years ago, when Jimmy Carter became the president of the United States, President Carter proudly talked about the importance of human rights. The human rights must be a basis of American foreign policy. But right now, the President of the United States does not have a vocabulary of human rights, democracy, freedom, and liberty. This is a surprise. And 30 years ago, when President Reagan went to West Berlin, in front of the Brandenburg Gate, Mr. Reagan asked, "Tear down this wall, Mr. Gorbachev." Mr. Reagan said so. But now, the President of the United States urges to create the wall between the United States and Russia. Something changes. The lack of the concepts of the human, or at least the vocabulary of human rights, democracy, freedom, these kind of things, it seems to me, certainly harms the value of the soft power of this country and the international public image of the United States. And creating the wall anywhere is not a symbol of strength, rather a symbol of weakness. I'm afraid of kind of isolationist temptation of this country right now. Having said so, in terms of the US-Japan security alliance, so far, our bilateral relationship is quite stable. Last month, US Secretary of Defense General Mattis visited South Korea and Japan, and he publicly told that the US-Japan alliance is a kind of a model case of a burden sharing, and he also clearly said that the Senkaku Island belongs to US-Japan Security Treaties. Article 5 covers Senkaku Islands. So many of the Japanese people and Japanese government very much released by Mr. Mattis' remarks. And also, Prime Minister Abe came to Washington a couple of weeks ago, and Mr. Abe and Prime Minister President Trump had a very fruitful discussions, and they went to Florida and enjoyed a grand golf. But speaking Mr. Abe's visit to Washington, I would say Mr. Abe is very much strategic, because before coming to Washington D.C., he went to the Philippines, and Indonesia and Australia. So he paid a visit to important Asian and Asian Pacific countries and came to Washington DC. So Japan can represent Asian Pacific region. Coming to Washington DC. As far as Japan is influential in the Asian Pacific region, Japan can be an important ally for the United States. But if Japan is isolated in the Asian Pacific region, Japan is not necessarily so important ally for the United States. So before coming to Washington, he paid a visit to the Asian Pacific countries. That is a very strategic. And what was exactly his grandfather did? Before coming to Washington, meeting President Eisenhower, Prime Minister Kishi paid a visit to Southeast Asian countries and gathering the information and bringing important advice to President Eisenhower about Southeast Asian situations. So respected in Asia, that is an essential condition for the US-Japan alliance from a Japanese perspective. So in this sense, Mr. Abe's visit to Washington was, I guess, very much strategic. So far, the US-Japan bilateral relationship is very stable, but having said so, on the Japanese side, still there are several concerns about the US-Japan alliance. The key word for Mr. Trump is unpredictability. So even now, the US-Japan alliance seems to be stable. Who knows next steps? It might be something unexpected might be happening on the American side. So Japan is still have kind of anxiety of unpredictability of this administration. And couple of concerns, you know, Mr. Trump's tactics. Well, I do not know in this country, but in Japan, Japanese mass media and public intellectuals occasionally or often said that Mr. Trump was originally, real estate billionaire. So what he does in Washington is like a businessman-like diplomacy, but businessman-like policy. Politics, deal, getting the profits, and as far as you can get the profits, you can promote the diplomacy and policy. So very much pragmatic and deal type of diplomacy or policy. So businessman type diplomacy or politics. Japanese media or public intellectuals often call Mr. Trump's businessman-like policy, blah, blah, blah. But my sense is what Mr. Trump is doing is far from a businessman-like. I don't think so. Once Japanese Prime Minister Yoshida Shigeru said that diplomacy and business are quite similar. Both of them, long-time credit is extremely important. Long-time credit, compromise, mutual understanding, and long-run perspectives. These kind of things are quite important. Short-time benefit. You may be able to get a big amount of a short-time benefit. But if you lack mutual confidence, respect, long-run perspective, your business will not be successful or long-run. Diplomacy is similar. You can do a very surprising diplomacy for short-run, but long-run, diplomacy by surprise cannot achieve or protect national interest. So business and diplomacy are similar. For both, long-time credit is very important. If it is correct, what Mr. Trump is doing right now is far from business-like. I don't think he's a businessman. He's just a salesman. Very short-sighted salesman. So for 4 years, what I expect is he may be able to become a businessman from a salesman. And from businessman to statesman, this is another step. But right now, my sense is that Mr. Trump is far from businessman life. He's a very short-sighted salesman life. So how this administration can obtain long-run perspective, mutual confidence, mutual trust, these kind of things, will be an essential challenge for American foreign policy and U.S. relationship. That's one thing I'd like to say. And in terms of the U.S.-Japan relationship, Mr. Trump's tactics, probably the tactics, is at the beginning, he does something quite surprising or non-common sense things, like talking with the Taiwanese president on phone and these kind of things. So something very surprising thing happens. Then later, he becomes more and more normal. But at the beginning, he was quite unusual and somehow surprising. So once he becomes normal, everybody praises him. So expectation was decreased. And once he becomes normal, everybody praises him. Even the U.S.-Japan relationship, one of the concerns is now Mr. Trump seems to be very tough to China, but he may change. He may change. And in the past 20 or 30 years, the American administration's almost constant pattern to China is beginning a very tough stance to China, criticizing China from the beginning, criticizing China. But any president realizes only 4 years or only 8 years, we cannot change China. So then, gradually getting moderate and compromising to China. From the antagonistic, very antagonistic style to moderate and compromising to China. This is a constant pattern of American policy towards China. Only exception, as far as I know, is Mr. Obama. Mr. Obama began from a very friendly, compromising attitude to China. But taking 8 years, he realized that we have to be tougher to China. So Obama administration, soft to tough. But except for Obama administration, usually American administration general pattern to China is tough to soft. And now Mr. Trump is talking about China very tough way. But who knows? He may be take a similar pattern, getting more and more compromising. And he might try to do the kind of a grand bargain with China. If China makes a compromise about trade and economic issues, and the U.S. may be able to deal with China in the security area. Such kind of deal is extremely dangerous for Japan. This is one concern. And the second concern is Mr. Trump tries to pursue a better relationship with Russia, which is fine, but cooperating with Russia, taking care of dealing with Syrian issue or IS issues, I'm afraid that probably cooperation between the United States and Russia about the IS and the Syrian issue works well, because national interests are so different over these issues. But anyhow, Mr. Trump tries to pursue cooperation with Russia over the Middle Eastern issues. As a consequence, the U.S. Diplomatic resources, energies, attentions are paying more and more to the Middle Eastern issues. Then, less resources, attentions, energies shall be paid to the Asian affairs, which will be a potentially dangerous for Japan. And also, Mr. Trump now talks a very tough way about the North Korean issue, but he may not do anything. During the 8 years of the Obama administration, of course, it is still very tough to evaluate the Obama administration at the present moment. I think Mr. Obama has been a very sincere president. He has tried to do a lot of things. But in terms of the, his policy toward Asia, most missing link was the policy toward North Korea. The Obama administration always talked about the strategic patience. But under the name of strategic patience, in my view, the Obama administration not do any effective measures to North Korea. As a consequence, North Korea repeated the nuclear tests, missile tests, and provocative actions and increased military capabilities. The Trump administration talking about very tough thing to North Korea, but even Trump administration will not do anything North Korea 4 more years or 8 more years, then North Korea will repeat nuclear test, missile test, and provocative actions. It will be extremely dangerous for Japan. Nowadays, I'm not a specialist of these kind of things, but security specialist or intelligence specialist often say that North Korea may have 10 or 15 nuclear warheads. And 4 more years, 8 more years, North Korea nuclear warheads, the number of North Korea nuclear warheads from 10 to 15 to 40 or 15, or 90 and 100. It will be a completely different strategic environment for Japan. If North Korea should possess a 40 or 50 nuclear warheads, it means our neighborhood will become Israel. And if North Korea possess 90 or 500 nuclear warheads, it means our neighborhood will become Pakistan. It will be an extremely dangerous situation. Unfortunately, you know, now Mr. Trump became the president of the United States, and some Japanese people have a kind of a concern of the future of the US-Japan relations. Of course, it is also an opportunity for us to strengthen our relationship. But at the same time, you know, in South Korea, President Park lost the power almost simultaneously. So it's extremely difficult for us to promote Japan, South Korean, and American trilateral security cooperation, or South Korean Japanese bilateral security cooperation. So generally speaking, security environment surrounding Japan is very tough. And of course, as I mentioned, Mr. Trump's becoming the presidency gave us a very important opportunity to reconsider, re-evaluate, rethink Japan's security policy and Japan's strategic environment basically. So this is a very good opportunity for us. What we can do is pragmatically speaking very limited, but a couple of things I'd like to mention is so far Japanese government spend about 1% of GDP as a defense budget, but given the strategic environment such as the North Korean provocative actions, the rise of China, it is enough. The NATO allies promised to spend about 2% of GDP. Probably Japan cannot spend 2% the GDP for the defense budget, but we may be able to increase some amount of defense budget. Recently, a major think tank in Tokyo proposed about 1.2% of the GDP as a defense budget. So we have to think about a possibility of spending more for our defense budget. Talking about the defense budget, however, you know, when Mr. General Mattis came to Japan and when Mr. Abe visited Washington, D.C., Japanese government was very eager to get the promise from the American government the senkaku should be covered under the Article 5 of the US-Japan Security Treaty. But whatever we get the promise from the United States government, to what extent Japan tries to protect the Senkaku Islands? What's our own efforts shall be seriously asked? And so far, for example, you know, if maritime self-defense forces confront with the Chinese Navy, this is an extremely dangerous scenario, right? But before going to a confrontation between Chinese Navy and Japanese maritime self-defense forces, to what extent Japanese maritime guard what's that? Do you say Kaijo Mansho in English?
Coast Guard.
Coast Guard, Japanese Coast Guard. To what extent Japanese Coast Guard can protect Senkaku Islands and others? And how much Japan spend Coast Guard annually? Previously, Japanese government spent Coast Guard, for Coast Guard, 180 billion yen previously. And this time, the Ministry of Transportation proposed a 200 billion yen budget, and the government admitted 210 billion yen for Coast Guard, which is a very good indication. But still, protecting Japan has more than 6,000 islands, right? And more than 6,000 islands protecting this territory, just about 200 billion yen is enough. So we have to think about this. So we have to, probably you have to pay more for defending ourselves. And cyber security is a very weak area for the Japanese security. And 2 years ago, as you may know, Japan passed the new peace and security legislation under which also limited the collective self-defense, the right of collective defense can be exercised. And I myself testified before the House of Representatives, and I supported this bill. And I was criticized by several people, but from now, I think it was a very necessary step in my personal view. And many people criticize that this new legislation is unconstitutional. But thinking about the cyber security issues, it seems to be almost impossible to make a distinction between individual and collective self-defense in the area of cyber security. And when Japanese constitution was drafted, cyber space has not existed. So now we are faced with a security environment which constitution does not assume. So cyber security is an extremely important area. And intelligence gathering, we have to do more. So we have to think about what Japan alone can do, and what Japan alone cannot do, and what Japan and US combined can do and cannot do, and US and Japan, and in future, South Korea, Australia, and Southeast Asia countries, multilateral framework, what we can do and what we cannot do. We have to seriously consider and prepare for the next generation. Thank you very much. Then I'd like to ask the wisdom from Mr. Benjamin himself.
Thank you, Koji. Thank you all for coming. It's a great honor to be invited to share the table here with Professor Murata, who with no notes at all, just provided a complete broad coverage of the important issues in US-Japan alliance relations. For you. I was in Japan last week and I had a couple of chances to talk to groups of strategic thinkers about Japan's long-term expectations and concerns on the US-Japan alliance. And I'll report on those first by talking about what I presented to them as the kind of questions and the framework of analysis that I brought to it, which is to basically figure out what it is that Trump wants, starting from what Trump wants. And there are basically three possible logics of Trump's policy that are shared. The first logic is chaos. That is, that this is a completely disorganized administration, and that there are a number of initiatives coming and going from different individuals. There's no overall coordination, and this leads to the possibility of Trump shocks, that we've already heard about, that there's no consistency or logical framework. And this sub-varieties of chaos, so this incompetence of this administration or the civil war has been suggested between old-line GOP, like Reince Priebus, the chief of staff, and the new extremist wing under Bannon. That tension between Priebus and Bannon is seen as an indicator of where this civil war model of the chaos theory might develop. And if you see one of them emerging and the other one being shunted aside, you might have some trajectory of where that civil war model might lead towards a more stable policy environment. I'm not really a believer in that logic, but it is widespread, and it's worth preparing for. The potential for a Trump shock or a black swan is quite high. In fact, the term black swan refers to an extraordinarily rare event. I like to think of the trumpeter swan, which is a much more common bird. And we are getting a lot more Trump shocks than we got previously. The second model or logic of Trump policy that's widespread both in the United States and in Japan is the kind of narcissism model, the egocentric billionaire. There's no doubt in anybody's mind that Trump is egotistical and largely egocentric. That is, the whole world revolves around Donald Trump. And the things that make him feel happy are the things that he will promote for the United States, regardless of their consequences to the national interest or to society at large. And that model means flattering or building up his ego can be an effective tool for managing relations with Trump. I think there's a certain degree to which that has penetrated the minds of everybody who has to deal with him, that his ego is the biggest single factor to calculate. But again, that's not the line I go with. I go with the third logic of Trump policy, which is his voter base, that Trump is placating or pandering to particular elements in the core Trump constituencies. And I'll just trot out a few examples of what I consider to be pandering, which are the executive actions that he's taken since assuming office, right? President Trump immediately withdrew from the TPP, which was pandering to the blue-collar voters in the upper Midwest states, like Michigan, Wisconsin, Ohio, and Pennsylvania. They're anti-trade because they feel trade has eroded American manufacturing jobs, which is not true, but they believe that. And they blame foreign countries on the economic problems in their areas. So he pulled out of TPP. Even though I think the consensus is that a TPP framework is a good thing for the United States. That is, overall, the US economy would benefit, and the global economy would benefit, and US leadership in Asia would benefit. Anyway, another example of pandering was the ban on Muslim immigration to the United States. Definitely pandering to an extremist subgroup of Trump supporters who are strongly Islamophobic, right? Based on decades of propaganda about the Islamic world and the threat that militant Islam poses to the United States, there are in American society, they're fringe groups, but in the Trump support base, they're a core element, and he pandered to them with this very poorly thought out ban on immigration, right? It was ruled illegal. But it's also revealed that he never consulted with a number of the other parties that should be part of a process to produce such a change in U.S. policy. For example, the House Committee on Subcommittee on Immigration is chaired by Jim Sensenbrenner. He never was consulted. The Homeland Security Secretary Kelly was never informed that this was coming. So. It's really just about a message to his voter base. On evangelicals, and I think they're a tremendously important constituency. I don't think Trump could have won without winning the evangelical vote, and they are concerned primarily about the Supreme Court and abortion. And he provided them with a Supreme Court nominee who is very definitely one of them and sees the world in the same way as the evangelicals. You've seen Trump praying with a group of evangelical visitors to the White House. Trump praying is a little mind-boggling to me because he's the least religious president I can remember. And that image alone is part of what makes me feel it's not only about narcissism, right? He wouldn't have a picture of himself holding hands and head bowed, praying with evangelicals, if it were all about Trump. It's about satisfying that voter base. The fourth group that I want to mention now that you pandered to are the xenophobes, more broadly, the anti-immigration community. And he's promised to build the wall. And he set forth border protection and immigration enforcement directives that are extremely controversial. And he's rounding up long-term residents of the United States and deporting them simply for being here illegally. In other words, not going after criminal gangs, but going after employed mothers who just happen to have come here illegally. Why is he doing that? Well, they're not doing any harm to the United States by being here, working in jobs that need done. But he's pandering to the anti-Latino American community. So whether they're white racial primacy types, the white power types, or whether they're simply afraid of social change that comes from immigration. Trump has pandered to all of these, and I think when you focus on the voter base, you understand there's a logic to Trump's policies that can be predicted a little better than based on the chaos theory. And so far, I think it's a more accurate way of understanding. That's not to say there isn't chaos in the Trump cabinet. We've already seen Mike Flynn resign after 24 days, which was, what, 163rd of Kissinger's term?
Kissinger served 2,500 days, so 103 times longer.
103 times longer. Well, that's a pretty short stint at 24 days. The thing I want to now get at is Japan's place in the world of Trump supporters, right? Trump's relationship with Japan would be driven primarily by the questions of the interests of his voter base, according to the third logic. There may be elements of the first two, chaos or civil war within the administration, and narcissism. And I think the Japanese side understood all of those elements when they put forward their plan to deal with President Trump, and Prime Minister Abe brought the omiyage of substantial U.S. investment into the U.S. by the Japanese side in order to partly flatter President Trump and make him feel like he was getting what he wanted, right? Visitors to the Chinese court bring tribute. Mm-hmm. So some kind of tribute to President Trump makes him feel like the center of the world, and he likes that. But more importantly, it's jobs in the United States, right, that this investment brings. America first means blue-collar jobs, and that's what the Japanese investment is able to provide. So it gives him cover for a friendly relationship with a foreign country. Most foreign countries, Americans, at least in the core constituency of xenophobes, Americans are uncomfortable about foreign countries. Germany and England may be different because so many Americans are of German or English extraction, and the English speak our language. Japan is potentially seen as an other society by many parts of America, right? Especially in the rural areas. Japan is very exotic and strange. So there's a potential for that Trump base group to be quite anti-Japan. And Trump floated, if you remember, several trial balloons targeting Japan in his campaign and in the aftermath of his campaign before becoming president. My estimation of how those trial balloons worked for him was that they didn't. In other words, there wasn't a great deal of resonance among the Trump base for targeting Japan. And therefore, once Trump came into office, he didn't have rigid restrictions on what kind of Japan policy he could pursue. He didn't have that kind of, this is a very important or a number one issue to an important constituency. It's not really a major issue to anybody in the Trump camp. And so Trump has some more leeway to pursue what he wants. In this, how Japan could manage Trump, I think, we talked earlier about the important role that METI bureaucrats have played in devising a strategy of bringing investment to the United States. My boss at the Mansfield Foundation, Frank Januzzi, points out that it's not really new money. Japan has, over the past couple of years, invested on the order of $30 billion a year in the United States. So going forward, what Prime Minister Abe effectively promised was just a continuation of that trend. Not a huge new surge in investment, but basically sustaining the high levels of investment that existed even under the Obama administration. So if you have a more business-friendly, lower tax environment going forward, it's even more attractive to Japanese investment. It doesn't require a huge effort on the part of the Japanese government to deliver that. One point I wanted to make about the results of Prime Minister Abe's visit was this guarantee of Japanese defense, Senkaku's Article 5, but more broadly, the response to the Musudan launch by North Korea while they were having dinner in Mar-a-Lago. And Trump came out saying that the U.S. was 100% behind Japan, right? And barring a radical shift, like a sudden black swan, that's a continuation of longstanding U.S. policy. And here, the complaints that Trump made about being handed a mess when he took over strike me as exactly the opposite in the case of Japan. He's the benefit of a huge legacy asset of decades-long cooperation between the U.S. and Japan to strengthen the partnership. Since 1994 and the security declaration between President Clinton and Prime Minister Hashimoto, the two sides have worked progressively, incrementally, to continually strengthen defense cooperation and build the basis of the alliance. And that legacy asset is carried forward institutionally by momentum. So even in the absence of Deputy Assistant Secretaries of Defense, the U.S. Defense Department is cooperating with the Japanese Ministry of Defense. There's still, even in this interregnum, there's still tangible cooperation and progress being made. All of that is a legacy asset. It's all momentum in the U.S.-Japan relationship. And Trump will certainly claim credit for any successes, but it's not a new trend. That said, the conversations I had last week in Tokyo highlighted a different level of concern. It's not a level of concern about the bilateral relationship. There's a belief that the bilateral relationship between the US and Japan can be managed well. The interests of the two countries and the processes and the number of pipes or channels that exist between the US and Japan mean the bilateral relationship should be stable. And here, a key point is the Pence-Aso relationship that was established. It didn't get mentioned, but that's a very important tool that the Japanese side proposed, right? Because Pence, governor of Indiana, a site of major Japanese industrial investment, has a very clear understanding of the benefits to the United States of the economic partnership with Japan, and is much more, aside from the evangelical side, a conventional Republican, not a radical Tea Party Republican. And so working with Aso and Pence allows for a much more managed, bounded, and predictable U.S.-Japan partnership. And I think that's very shrewd of the Japanese side. But beyond the bilateral, we have serious concerns coming out of Tokyo. The regional dimension is a concern, and Koji's already discussed potential for China policy to be a radical departure. So far, knock on wood, President Trump has come around to a traditional one China stance and continues to hold the position that North Korean nuclear weapons are unacceptable and we don't proceed with a regional proliferation and a kind of mutually assured destruction on a regional level by having South Korea and Japan acquire their own nukes. We continue to work to prevent North Korea from having nuclear weapons. So as of now, even the regional level in Northeast Asia and perhaps Asia more broadly is a continuation of the rebalance of the U.S. longstanding policy. And you hear that from General Mattis, and you hear that from Secretary Tillerson, that basically the U.S. framework for dealing with Asia is to preserve stability and to preserve U.S. engagement to guarantee that stability. But on a global level, the ability and willingness of the United States to sustain the global order that we established after World War II, and the institutions of that global order, like the United Nations, and the WTO, and the IMF and World Bank, all of that is under increasing concern, a matter of doubt and increasing concern. If the US cannot sustain the global order, what is the underlying rationale of the US-Japan alliance? Is it only the narrow self-interest of the two countries? Japan recommitted to the US-Japan alliance in the post-Cold War era out of a double-pillared ideological and interest basis. That is to say, shared values and shared interests in maintaining the global order. Japan would emerge as an important supporter of the global order, not just the regional order, but globally, across a range of capabilities, economic and even military, in order to sustain what the US had initially built in 1945. If Trump abandons that, that is, if Trump walks away from US provision of global public goods, over the long term, there was a lot of doubt in Tokyo whether Japan can continue to invest in that, because it's only America. It's not just America first, it's America first, middle, and last. And that's not what Japan wants or expects. So with that, I'd like to turn it over and ask the audience to ask us questions.
Thank you very much, Ben. Listening to Ben's ideas or comments, it reminded me of a couple of points which I did not mention. You mentioned shared values and shared interest. Mm. And speaking of shared value, as I pointed out, now the President of the United States does not speak about the human rights, mm-hmm. democracy, and freedom. But even though the President of the United States does not speak about human rights, freedom, and democracy, we have to. Japan should speak out democracy, the importance of democracy, freedom, and human rights. Because we have been talking about the importance of democracy, human rights, and freedom, not because the United States does. We believe so. That's why we are talking about the importance of human rights and democracy. So even though American president does not speak the importance of human rights and democracy and freedom, we have to continuously talk about the importance of freedom and democracy and liberty. That's one thing. And another thing is, you pointed out core Trump constituencies, or Rust Belt, and other areas. You know, for a long time, probably, Japanese politicians or bureaucrats, scholars, journalists, the so-called establishment aides, paying more attention to the East Coast and West Coast of the United States. Boston, New York, Washington, or San Francisco, Los Angeles, they are major economic powers and political powers and cultural and academic powers. But now, inside the United States, Rust Belt and other areas, dramatically changing. So we have to pay more attention to various areas of the United States, not only the East Coast and West Coast, elite kind of America. Well, you know, Japan is a, what shall I say, a maritime power. The United States is also a maritime power. So the US-Japan alliance, after the World War II, is a kind of alliance between the two maritime powers. But now, the United States has a land power, dramatically changing. So we have to pay more attention to various areas or different aspects of the American societies. Otherwise, I will misunderstand as a very complicated American societies. So, you have any additional comments? Or?
I actually forgot one point,
please.
If you don't mind. You ended your remarks talking about the potential for multilateral cooperation with Australia and other friendly countries in the United States, to the United States and to Japan. And I'm concerned that links up to my concluding point about U.S. willingness to provide public goods and maintain the global system. I think the U.S. and the basis of Trump's support is quite unilateral sometimes isolationist, but regardless of whether they're isolationist or interventionists, they're primarily unilateralists. That is, they don't want to consult, they don't want to ever consider obtaining permission before acting. So even if the U.S. decides it wants to intervene, it may not consult Japan first, and it may not obtain a consensus among like-minded states to act on a multilateral basis. If it wants Japan to do something, it will be a bilateral, not a multilateral. I think until we have a change in the White House, we're unlikely to be able to promote the kind of multilateral framework that you discussed, which was very much the core of the Obama administration's thinking on how to manage the rise of disruptive actors like China.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. You may have some questions or comments. Please raise your hands if you have comments or questions and identify yourself, please.
I'm Kelsey. I work at Eurasia Group. I have a question about the role that Japan could potentially play in Southeast Asia, particularly with ASEAN, if the U.S. decides to sort of pull back in that sense. I think FDI under Obama increased twofold in the region, but it looks like that may or may not continue. Whereas Japan sort of has the opportunity now to really step up their own investment in political involvement. I was wondering what you see the likelihood of that dynamic is.
Any hard question?
Oh, I get the hard question. I assume you were asking him. I don't believe there is an ASEAN. I'm a skeptic about the concept of ASEAN as an entity. There are 10 member countries, and they're all different, and their economies are different, and the investment environment is different, and the interests of the United States and Japan, and their political, that is, global political orientation varies dramatically, right? We know that some of them are basically suzerain states to China, Cambodia, Laos, increasingly Thailand. Others are strongly resistant and concerned about the China threat, like Vietnam. Others are one or the other, like the Philippines. We don't know which way that's going to go yet, but I tend to feel for strategic regions that the Philippines won't fall into the Chinese orbit the way Cambodia, for example, has. The economies that are targets of Western and Japanese investment in Southeast Asia will continue to be. For example, trade with Vietnam is going to keep growing. Vietnam is focused on exports as a model for export-led growth like Japan, Korea, Taiwan. Their total trade is now, 170% of GDP. So they're very much focused on trade as a way to develop and modernize, and they're not going to back away from that because of the failure of TPP, for example. So U.S. companies will keep investing there, bilateral trade will keep growing. Whether that's true of all the economies in the region, I mean, it's obviously highly volatile. What might happen in Indonesia, where investment was more natural resource focused anyway, commodity prices are way down because China's growth has slowed and the price of oil is low. So there's no one ASEAN and there's no one answer to that kind of question. Clearly, Prime Minister Abe has prioritized Southeast Asia. He did the in his first year in office, visited all 10 ASEAN members and continues, as Koji mentioned, before coming to the United States, he visited the region again. So Japan considers the region, Southeast Asia, as very important. Some in Japan consider ASEAN as important, although most of them don't. They focus really much more directly on the markets, the economies, and the pools of labor that are available in Southeast Asia. And very much aware always of the China factor in the region. So, is that an answer?
Yeah. So you don't see a Japan sunny lands for ASEAN anytime soon?
Well, who would come?
ASEAN. In a way to potentially balance. They had the U.S. and they had China, and that was kind of a thing that they could balance. And now if the U.S. is not going to help them out, Japan's not going to be something that they could grab onto.
I think Japan would be something that ASEAN can rely on and use Abe, what did Yuki Tatsumi call him, the pipe? Use Prime Minister Abe as a pipe to Trump? In other words, that maybe President, Philippines is a bad example. Leaders in Southeast Asia could have Abe speak on their behalf and use the strong U.S.-Japan relationship to keep the U.S. engaged as well. So there's definitely a sense that there is a big role for Japan, but I just have trouble with the concept that ASEAN exists, let alone that it has an interest.
I agree with Ben. I do not have any particular knowledge about the economic aspects of Southeast Asia and Japan, but you know, as I told you, Mr. Trump as the president, almost at the same time, President Park losing power in South Korea, and almost simultaneously, King Kumipon passed away in Thailand, simultaneously. It is symbolic for me. The Southeast Asian countries' economic and political situations are getting more and more destabilizing, not necessarily so stable as it was before. And under these circumstances, as Ben pointed out, Japan in particular, the Abe cabinet, can play an important bridging role. So I think the Philippines is quite a good example, you know. Now the Philippines, the government of Philippines has a difficulty to keep a good relationship with the American government, but Japan has a good relationship with the Philippines, and Japan has a good relationship with the United States. So bridging between them is an important role for us. And other thing is, you know, in the Southeast Asian countries, a bunch of new middle classes are emerging. Millions of middle classes are emerging in the Southeast Asian societies. To what extent American and Japanese higher education can absorb these newly emerging middle classes in Southeast Asia will be a very important task for our societies. Dozo.
Thank you for wonderful presentation. I'm Junjiro Shida at Sasaka Peace Foundation USA. I'm a visiting fellow. I investigate the US-Japan alliance in the context of the Asia-Pacific region. I want to know about your opinion, the Sensei's opinion, about the one timing issues. According to the Japanese media, the small portion of the Japanese politicians within LDP, leading party in Japan, started to assess whether Japan possessed the offensive capabilities such as strategic bomber, or ICBM, or the attack aircraft carrier to attack so-called preventively their adversary country's assets. So there, as you mentioned before, you stressed that we have to think about what Japan can do by Japan itself. So that in this context, this new kind of development in the LDP or the debate on the whether Japan can possess the offensive capabilities in the context of the Japan's individual self-defense rights. So how can we evaluate these things? So please tell me your opinion. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Touchy. Delicate question, I guess. But as you pointed out, some of the politicians are now arguing that, you know, because Japan's defense budget is limited. Even though Japan tries to increase our defense budget, still our resources are limited. And how to allocate our limited budget, defense resources, effectively? You know, North Korea is developing missile capabilities. In the near future, they may be able to put the nuclear warheads with their missiles. So one possibility is increase defense capabilities such as Aegis, or patriot, deterrence by denial of capability, but it may be not so effective given a North Korean military or missile development. So other possibilities are deterrence by punishment. Japan possesses the capability to attack enemies, particular areas. If you attack Japanese territory, we can attack your territories. Such kind of a retaliatory capability Japan tried to develop. That is a possibility. Several problems is, first of all, Komeito is very reluctant. Another governmental partner, Komeito is still very reluctant to develop such kind of preventive or offensive military capability. That is one thing. And second thing is, if Japan develops such kind of capability to attack enemy territories, side effects, even though Japan said that we are just focusing on North Korean provocative actions, how China reacts, or how South Korea reacts, and other countries' reactions, we have to think of these negative aspects. It's not easy to give a clear answer, but we have to discuss various possibilities, including developing such kind of capabilities and within a limited defense allocations.
I'd say first that preemptive strike is not unconstitutional, according to the Japanese logic of approving the constitutionality of nuclear weapons. Japan could, although it has laws against nuclear weapons separately, the interpretation is that the Constitution itself does not make nuclear weapons illegal. So it's the same basic framework that offensive strike is outside the policy guidance of Senshugoi, defense first, but it's not unconstitutional by itself. It's unpopular with the Komeito, but it wouldn't be a violation or require a change in the Constitution. But I think that when you're talking about a potential North Korean ballistic missile attack on Japan, Japan's ballistic missile defense systems now and in the future should be effective up to a certain threshold. That is, they're quite sophisticated and they're improving. The latest SM3 Block 2A is a really good interceptor missile. It was just demonstrated as such. Japan is considering THAAD in addition to the Aegis, or perhaps Aegis ashore, but another land-based ballistic missile defense system. In combination with existing strike capabilities that Japan's ally, the United States, possesses, these are sufficient. In other words, North Korea is not going to be able to launch enough ballistic missiles to attack Japan and penetrate the defensive system before those missiles and before North Korea as a whole can be destroyed by US counterstrike. So as long as Japan has the extended deterrent guarantee, and for the first time it was mentioned explicitly in the bilateral statement, for the first time since the 1970s, that the US nuclear umbrella was explicitly mentioned by the President and Prime Minister in their joint statement. A statement, I'm told, was drafted by the Japanese government. So it was kind of a request from Tokyo for more assurance on the nuclear side, and it was given by the United States. So I don't think there's really the driving force necessary for Japan to consider large-scale offensive strike capability. That said, smaller scale, like maybe Tomahawk cruise missiles or something similar, maybe some ground strike capability added to existing aircraft, is a possible step that could be justified in terms of even the Senkaku Islands defense, right? If you had a Chinese takeover of the Senkaku Islands, for Japan to take them back, Japan would have to be able to attack those positions. It's Japanese territory, so it wouldn't be an aggressive attack on another country, but they would have to be able to strike positions on the Senkakus where Chinese troops were in place, and to do that, they would have to obtain capabilities they don't currently have.
Any other questions or comments, please?
A reporter from Voice of America. I just want you whether you guys could comment on the President Trump's comments last night on alliance and their allies. He mentioned that our allies will find that America is once again ready to lead. So that does not give you confidence that the United States will not bend the leadership. Am I making myself
clear? I think so. I think I understand your question. Do you want to?
Please.
The way I interpret President Trump's comment on that is as an insult or a complaint about President Obama's approach to international politics, relying on other countries to step up and provide some leadership rather than depending solely on the United States to be the first one to try to address a problem and then build a consensus in support of the U.S. position. So actually, President Obama tried to delegate some matters to other countries, allies, for them to take more responsibility. And ironically, in a different way, Trump is also trying to get other countries to take more burden, but is asserting the centrality of US leadership and presuming that other countries will follow. But it's not a matter of US leadership for sustaining the global order, it's a matter of US leadership for pursuing US interests and still presuming that allies will follow because they rely on the United States, that they will be compelled to accept the US position out of dependency. So I'm not as reassured. There are ways to interpret those words as reassuring to allies, but I don't interpret them that way.
Any other questions or comments?
Said everything I have to say today.
We still have time.
Well,
okay, please.
François from the Canadian Embassy. Actually, as you said, Shinzo Abe has been pretty proactive in the Australia, Philippines, and Malaysia, but he was not really proactive with other, like American countries, who was part of the TPP, so Canada and so Chile. Can we expect Shinzo Abe to be more proactive toward other ally who was part of the TPP in the months to come?
TPP?
Will Abe be reaching out to Canada, Mexico, other TPP
American
signatories?
Is it part of his agenda?
What I heard in Tokyo is that the Japanese will wait for the NAFTA renegotiation issue to be resolved before touching anything among NAFTA members, including the United States. So that they don't want to be out in front of or begin a bilateral U.S.-Japan discussion until the U.S. has resolved that. And their hope, quietly, is that basically the NAFTA renegotiation will be a way to move TPP into NAFTA, right? A lot of what the Republicans, or what Trump and his people seem to want out of the NAFTA renegotiation is what TPP concluded on, pretty close. And so it's possible, from the Japanese point of view, to wait, have NAFTA basically incorporate the existing TPP framework, and then pursue a bilateral with the US on the basis of incorporating a quasi-TPP going forward. So they haven't given up hope that all the negotiations and the political capital invested by Prime Minister Abe to achieve TPP, they still are hoping that will pay some dividend. And given the quality of the high standard agreement reached at TPP, there's good reason to expect that nobody will do better than that. I hope that's a sense of how they're prioritizing time.
Any other comments or questions? Oh, please.
Etienne from American University. You told us that there was some concern in Japan on the long term that if the US was moving back from its role as guarantor of the international order, what would happen long term? And what is your sense of what Japan envisages if that is the case? Can we move more towards Asia and concentrate in that direction? Or?
So I put forward five cute animal scenarios for what Japan might do. One, the first was koala, which clings to the US like a koala holds on to a eucalyptus tree. So regardless of what the US pursues, Japan will just hold on for dear life. The second was gorilla, maybe not so cute, but it's the idea that Japan would become a major power in international politics, like Imperial Japan, a great power pole pursuing its own sphere of influence and its own national interests in competition with other states, kind of independent Japan. The third I called the meerkat, which is a South African animal, you know, lives in Southern Africa. It's a communal animal. It cooperates with other animals like itself to survive in a threat-rich environment. So this is a model of akin to Soya Sensei's middle power diplomacy. And it's a matter of Japan and other middle tier countries cooperating to sustain their collective interests, even while the great big lions like the United States and China are prowling around, the hyenas and the lions and so on. That's the meerkat. Then there's the panda. What does the panda mean? Well, it means cuddling up to China and accepting Chinese leadership of the region, Chinese hegemony, and becoming a supporter of the Chinese-led regional order. And the fifth and final I called the hedgehog. And the hedgehog is like an isolationist Japan from 19th Sakoku Jidai, the 18th and 19th centuries, when Japan basically withdrew from the world, did not accept that it was part of the Sinocentric regional system, right? Japan refused to accept Chinese domination of it, at least, even if it acceded that China was dominant on the continent and maybe in Southeast Asia, would not control Japan. But the hedgehog needs spikes on its back to protect itself. So in this model, Japan would have to be militarily stronger than it is now to sustain its independence in the face of a rising China and a US that's in decline and abandoning it. So the most popular among the military officers was the koala. That is, just based on the momentum of Japan's alliance and the structures and institutions, Japan would continue to cleave to the United States. But there was quite a bit of diversity among others, and I think that the smartest person in the room said hedgehog. That wasn't me. I wasn't the smartest person in the room. But I thought until the United States, or until some new global order could be reestablished and Japan could play an outward role again, Japan would huddle in on itself and bide its time, never accepting China. Only one person said panda among all the people I talked to. Does that give you a fair sense?
Well, I do not have a direct answer to your question, but the United States might withdraw from the Asia-Pacific region. This has been repeatedly asked question, never happens as a matter of fact. It depends on the definition of the retreat or withdrawal. Now we have a very unique president of the United States, even after the Trump administration, the US-Japan alliance continues. We have to have a longer perspective beyond the Trump administration. And the anecdote recently I speak often is at the beginning of the 20th century, the United States established a new immigration law. 1924, I guess, and under this law, the immigrants from Japan was almost prohibited. So in Japan, this law was often called the anti-Japanese immigration law. Of course, this law does not necessarily target Japan alone, but from the Japanese perspective, this law was often called the anti-Japanese immigration law. And at that time, Japanese ambassador to the United States, Shidehara Kijuro, he later became the foreign minister and prime minister. And Shidehara was very concerned about the future of the US-Japan relationship because this is a very discriminative legislation against Japan. So many Japanese people are furious. This is racism or discrimination. So Shidehara was very concerned about the future of the US-Japan relationship. So Shidehara admired very much a British ambassador to the United States, James Bryce. He was a famous historian and diplomat. And Shidehara went to Mr. Bryce, and he asked advice to Mr. Bryce. Mr. Bryce's answer is that your country, Japan, are you lady ho fighting against the United States over this issue? Means that are you ready to go to the United States over this legislation? The ambassador Shidehara answered, "Of course not. We are not going to war with the United States over this legislation." Okay, if it is the case, you should protest to the American government logically. And after that, keep silence. This country can change itself. This country can figure out their own mistakes by themselves. So we can trust this country's self-correctness or the capability of correcting itself. And national interest is eternal. So just 10 years, 20 years is almost nothing for eternal national interest. So you have to look at the longer-term national interest of your country. That is advice by the British ambassador to the Japanese ambassador. And I guess this is still a correct to the current situation. The U.S. may make some mistakes, but this country can change itself. Well, I'm very confident about American society and committing to the Asian Pacific region is certainly a national interest of this country. Temporarily, the U.S. may withdraw from this area, but in the longer run, I'm very confident about American commitment to the area and American commitment to international order and international justice.
I wish I were as optimistic. I do believe that America can correct itself. I appreciate that anecdote, and I will steal that. But the relative power of the United States in the international system will continue to decline. It's not a matter that the U.S. is itself in decline. The U.S. will continue to grow, become more prosperous, become more powerful. But the rise of the rest is just going to make it harder and harder for the U.S. to dominate the global order and to exercise U.S. power on a global scale. It's inevitable that if it's not Trump and if it's not this decade, but there will be a point where not the willingness but the ability of the United States to sustain this system will erode past a certain danger point. Now, our assumption is that the U.S. can obtain the cooperation of allies and like-minded beneficiaries of the current order to sustain it. That was the paradigm that we had developed and hoped that even as the U.S. declines, Japan or Europe or Canada can bear more of that burden and keep it going well beyond the ability of the U.S. alone to sustain it. Maybe Trump is hastening that point, and maybe it will come too soon, but I don't know that U.S. interest alone is enough if U.S. lacks capacity, and it's a long-term concern. That said, though, the other thing that doesn't change is globalization. And the trend of technology and the trend of globalization will not stop just because Trump has pulled out of TPP, and the impact of globalization will not go away for the core voters who are upset about it. You know, a lot of Americans, both on the left and the right, are unhappy with what globalization has done to certain parts of the United States, but it's not going away.
Okay, thank you. Well, I might be optimistic, but at the same time, we do not know the future direction of China. And China has a lot of vulnerability, and so let me add another point is that how difficult to predict the future. For example, the end of 1980s, at the peak of Japanese economy, some Japanese think tank, a very famous Japanese think tank, if I mention the name, everybody knows, very famous Japanese think tank predicts if this trend continues with the rise of Japan, probably 30 years later, Japan will be the largest economy in the world. This prediction completely wrong, right? Now Japan is the third largest economy in the world, not the largest economy in the world. So even the economic development, predicting 20 or 30 years, extremely difficult. I always talk to my Japanese students at a famous American film, Back to the Future Part 2. Back to the Future Part 2 predicted the world of 2015. And this film was produced in 1989. And the world of 2015 in that film, automobiles fly. But nobody used a cell phone. In 1989, even Hollywood producers could not imagine the spread of the cell phones. So if something unexpected innovation happens, economic direction or economic speed completely changes. So of course, we can predict, for example, the growth of a population or decrease of population, these kind of things. But at the same time, we have to be very careful about how limited our capability to predict the future. So in the short term, I would say we have to be very careful, but in short term, we have to be somehow pessimistic, but in the long term, we may be pessimistic. Any other comment or questions?
Can I ask another one?
If an easy question, accept.
You just mentioned the prediction of the Japanese think tank in 1989. And I remember I read an article by Business Insight. They mentioned that in 2040, it is Japan, not China, will become the greatest power in Asia. So, what's your view?
Completely wrong. please.
My name is Cheryl Jamana. I want to push back a little bit on Professor Murata, on his statement that President Trump is a salesman and not a businessman. I thought Mr. South's analysis of the three theories was very good. And I do think, and this is where I think the Trump administration divides the world up into who voted for him and who didn't vote for him. And if you voted for him and you're not happy today, then that would be a major concern. But what we heard yesterday from the Pew organization is that he has the highest standing among approval rating among Republican presidents. If you didn't vote for him and you're unhappy today, he doesn't care. And I think he basically has a two-year plan. And the first year is to shore up his base. The second year is to expand that base through jobs. And what he wants to achieve is, and what he has his eye on, is the 2018 elections, so that he can expand his, he's going to be in big trouble if he loses the Senate majority. So he needs to keep that and expand it. So when he has disaffections, as he has on a couple votes, he can hold that. And then if he sustains that in 2018, then that gives him potentially a second term in 2020. So I think people today should not overreact to his actions. And if he has got a two-year plan or a more strategic plan to key your reaction in interaction with the White House, put that in mind.
Well, of course, Mr. Trump, looking at the midterm election, November 2018 means less than 2 years later. As you pointed out, if he loses either upper house or lower house, he has big trouble. Even though Republicans can maintain the majority in the upper house or lower house, but still, even now, only 52 versus 48 in the Senate, right? So three or four Republican senators say no, then the majority cannot be got in the upper house. And so it is extremely difficult to maintain the consensus in the Republican Party for Mr. Trump. In the Democratic Party, they are very much anti-Trump, but Republicans are so diversified. Some are pro-Trump, and some are anti-Trump, and some are in between. And so very difficult to get a consensus or majority inside the Republican Party. And in particular, as Mr. Trump said that using a bunch of money to public investment, but cutting the budget. Cutting the budget means he makes some congressmen to enemies. So this will be a very nasty politics continues.
I don't have anything
to add. Okay. Any other questions or comments? Okay. So thank you very much for joining us, and a lot of interest in questions and comments. We have learned a lot from this session. Thank you very much.